So this video covers the SketchUp Foundations that I believe if anybody wants to understand SketchUp, you really need to get your head around all of these different functions within SketchUp. I'm going to go through them quite quickly. It will cover the drawing setup, accesses, views, selections, inference, input window, move, and the copy tool, guides, push, pull, arc, scale, follow me, groups, and components. So if you want to jump ahead because you need to know something about something, perhaps that's the way to go. For now, let's just jump straight into SketchUp. When we start SketchUp, now I have the pro version and I'm working on a Mac, so you might find some things are a little bit different, but in the main, it will be the same. One thing to point out I'll say now is that on a Mac, we press the Alt or Option key. When on a Windows computer, I believe it's the Control key to do things like change the tool from move to copy, but we'll get to that. So in starting, we would normally choose a template because we've got this little box ticked here saying show on startup. Now, SketchUp has various templates. Here in Australia, of course, we use the metric system, so we'll be looking for meters, millimeters, all of those units. I find, although this is a common one for many kids to learn on, it's a little bit cumbersome when it comes to printing out your work. We're not diving into layout yet, and so you might be doing your measurements and other drawings in SketchUp and printing straight from there, in which case you should avoid this one if you want, and go down to something that's a little more appropriate, especially for woodwork and engineering where we use millimeters. So scrolling down, I know this one says woodworking. Don't worry about it. It has a gray background. Again, that muddles up the way we can present our drawings. And for some reason, I find this one works better on axes, and I'll show you that in a sec. So interior and production design millimeters is what you should go for. Start using SketchUp. Now, perhaps the first thing I'll dive into is your units. Down here, we have measurements, and if your window does not show measurements, perhaps it's handy just to double-click the title bar. That usually changes your overall canvas size, if you like, to show the measurements. You really need this window down the bottom. If you don't have it, figure out how to get it sorted out. It sometimes is a problem in Windows. The units. Now, this template is set up for millimeters. I want to show you how we can change that. So we go to the menu window, model info, and then down here, it's already on it. You can click around, but units. Now, of course, we want decimals and precision. On this round of drawings, I might just go to a precision of no decimal points for our millimeters because we're not engineering, we're just woodworking, and I challenge anyone to get better than a millimeter on most work. Of course, you can change the units here. Typically, in woodwork and engineering, we generally only use, and construction drawings, of course, we use meters. Otherwise, millimeters. Centimeters really don't exist in many trade applications. You can set your precision with angles as well. I'd probably suggest to go for just zero. Enabling angle snapping is really handy if you're going to use arcs or other things like the protractor to rotate. It'll do it in 15 degree increments, which is handy because 15 and 15 is 30. 3 times 30 is 90. And so we cover most of the angles that you're likely to want to use. But do remember, if you've got some fiddly work, that you can go in there and change that as you need. With that said, our drawing is kind of ready to set up and get started. One thing, if you did set up your drawing and you've got that blue sky and green background, I'll just show you quickly, because this is a handy one to know about and it's often something hard to remember. I often do. So we go to Styles, Window Styles, and then over here, at the moment, we've got a default style. If we click on the In Model, you've got a whole bunch of different styles. Won't go there yet. We're just going to say In Model, and you can edit. Now here, we've got the different views that we can see our drawings. This one here is our background. So notice here we can click to the edge style, the face style of the objects we're doing, our background, our watermark, and modeling. So forget all that for now and go to background. If you want to see the sky and the ground, now I will just click here and show you that we've now got a sky and a background. So you might want to work and do something a little wild. to change your background. But I don't really want that, so I'm going to turn that off and turn that off. Get rid of this window. By the way, you can see that little icon suggesting that it's been edited. I don't want to change this default, if you like, so I'm not going to click that. But if you clicked it there, that would kind of update your style with the changes that you've made. So I'm not going to update that, but you can do that. That's for another lesson. Let's get rid of that. Okay. First thing to talk about is our accesses. When we're drawing, I've always found it easy for myself and probably teaching others as well. The blue axis is a solid line where we're above this point here. This little guy right at the middle there is called the origin. That's where all the axes meet. I normally put my objects above that plane, that if you can imagine a plane, a solid surface between the red and the green axes. So as this guy is standing above that plane, that's how you should sort of think about drawing. I wouldn't normally draw my objects right in the origin or start from there because they get lost on the axis, your line. So I do it normally start somewhere else. But back to that point, blue is up and down, green goes to the distance, near and far, and red kind of goes left and right. So if we had our tools and we were orbiting, we can orbit around and see that we're below the man, we're over this way, whatever. That's something just to sort of keep in mind with your accesses. When we are using our accesses, normally our lines, when we draw something, we would always draw them, that's not on an axis, but you watch as I go down, it snaps to red, it'll snap to green, and it'll snap to blue. You want all of your lines on an axis and usually all of your objects on an axis in some way. That'll make more sense as you do more drawing, but if you start drawing things like this, and then I go around, you can see it's kind of difficult to know what on earth we just drew. We've drawn something, but it's totally on a plane that's different to any of those axes, and that's not what I'd recommend. So draw your lines on axes. If you want to lock an axis, let's say you're doing something and you're having a hard time for whatever reason snapping to the green or the blue. So you've started to draw your line by clicking once, and then you want to make it lock to the red axis. What I've done, I just tapped my keyboard, arrow right. So my right arrow on the keyboard locks it, and now I can't get off that axis, and it will draw a line like that. I'll get rid of it. Command Z or Control Z, by the way, is the undo command. You need to learn that one off by heart. If I press the up arrow, guess what? It locks it to the blue. Now, let's just say I've forgotten and I now press the green. It will, the left arrow, it will lock it to the near and far. So you can see that we can switch between our axes. Escape on the keyboard is a very handy one just to kind of undo anything that you've started doing. So remembering that most of your lines, your surfaces, moving things, copying things will be along an axis, and please try to remember that. Viewing. Sometimes you get lost in SketchUp and you get too close to something, you can't figure out where on earth am I, it's just a big screen, I can't move around, I'm lost. There is a tool for that. It's called Zoom Extents. When you click this tool, you'll return to a view that covers everything that you've drawn. So if I drew just really quickly a great big rectangle like that and then zoomed in, now I'm going to press Zoom Extents. I now have zoomed out to the whole of my rectangle and also this guy. So you get the picture. Our mouse wheel, you might hear in the recording, zooms in and out. If you hover your tool, no matter which tool you're in, but I'll go to select to make it a bit neater. If you zoom in, you'll zoom in wherever your mouse pointer is. So hover your mouse over what you want to look at, see what's in his pocket, and that's where your zooming occurs. Handy one to know. Keyboard shortcuts. Now we've got this tool called the Orbit, and as I hover over it, that's interesting. Okay, we'll get to that. There are keyboard shortcuts and they can be seen in the other tools. I might jump straight to that actually. In our view, we want to be able to view our tool palettes. So we go to tool palettes. Now yours might look different. You might have to click a box to open something up, but what you want to do I normally would not have these tools up the top. I actually always look for large tool set. And then if you have a clickable box where you see other things, click getting started off. What that will do is get rid of this set of tools up the top. On my version, what I do is I go to customize toolbar. And what I like to do is drag, I have to do it individually. I won't do it, but normally I'd get rid of all those guys. But I do like to have these views. You guys probably don't have to at this stage, but it's handy to get used to. I will get rid of a few because, sorry guys. And then I'm going to drag this one. You can click and drag anything else you want if you want. What about we do time and shadows for a little bit of fun later on, and even section display. We'll get to that. So that being said, we can also click and use small size icons. You can see that, but I'll leave them big, and you can change so you can see the icon text only or icon and text. I like icon and text. So now I've got my toolbars on the side. I find that a lot easier because you can move them around if you need, and you've got extra info up here if you need. If I hover over here, one benefit you'll see is that you might have noticed now we have the O over orbit, and we'll have an H next to pan, and we'll have a Z for zoom. So learn those keyboard shortcuts if you can, and you'll probably find me through this video. I'm an absolute sucker for keyboard shortcuts. They're much, much quicker. And if I use them without saying what I'm doing, I'm sorry about that, but you'll probably work it out. O for orbit. I can zoom orbit around, which is very handy. If I've got myself lost and I'm upside down and I can't work out where the blue is or should be or something like that, usually this zoom extends, will return me, and it hasn't. So I might have to try to, I'm just going to click and drag, I'll click that again. Interestingly, it hasn't sorted it out. But anyway, if you drag left and right, you'll rotate that the correct way, up and down. And you can fix up that view. So try to always have your accesses in this way. Now we're going to get rid of this guy. So I just click him and delete. What I want to do is talk through selections. So a selection is how we select objects in SketchUp. And what I might do is very quickly just draw. A dodgy little rectangular box. When we select something, we can click on this tool here, by the way, by pressing spacebar. Now let's go to something else. Spacebar turns us back to our select tool. I can click on an edge and select it. I can click on a face and just select it. And of course then do anything like delete and so on, but we'll do that later. I can double click on, let's say, that edge, and what it does, it selects the two surfaces that are next to it. You get the picture? In the instructional, if you have the sheet, you'll see that double click also selects a group for editing. Hang on a sec. Sorry, so I was just saying, if you're reading the SketchUp Foundation handout, on the selection section, you might see double click also sets up a group for editing. What that means is if I made something into a group, if I double click it, it puts a box around the group. We'll get to that later on. So as I said, double clicking will select a face. Double clicking a surface will select all of the edges that connect to that surface. Triple click selects everything. Now that's a handy one to know, because later on we'll be talking about how to make a group, and maybe you want to triple click everything to select it so that you can move it or copy it. Triple clicking is an important one to know about. Now what I didn't say at the start of the talk was that the golden rule number one is always group or make components of all the different objects you draw. So if I wanted to build a Lego brick and this was the start of it, I might select it and make a group. I'll do that later. But I just wanted to point that out because it is a really, really important part of being able to draw in SketchUp. keeping on going with selections, if I drag from the right to the left, so I'm clicking off on a blank space somewhere, and I drag from the right to the left, and I just dragged over that much, do you notice how it selected everything that was within the box? Anything that's in the box and gets touched by it will be selected. But if I went the other way, notice the line is now solid, not dotted. It only selects everything that is wholly enclosed by that box. So half of the box, halfway down, up here, all this, is not completely enclosed, so it won't be selected. It's a handy way of sort of deciding when you've got an object and how much you want to select or not select. So the dotted box here will select everything, but not that end face or the lines, because none of those parts were inside the line. An important one to know about. But if you want to select everything, you can just completely go around it either way. And of course, you'll pick it all up. I hope that makes sense. Now, inference is a really, really important part. In fact, it's at the core of SketchUp. It's called their inference engine. And what it allows us to do, let's say we want to go for the line tool to do some drawing. It's ready for us to start drawing. I can click somewhere and just draw. That's really straightforward. Anyone can do that. But let's say I wanted to draw on my little rectangular box that I've made. As I hover over, it's already snapped or inferred on the edge. And if we stay still, it'll say it's on the edge. If we go down to the corner, it makes a green dot and it says endpoint. So it's at the end point of any of those three lines. But if I go over here, it goes blue and it says midpoint. Now, what if I were, I've covered endpoints, I've covered midpoints, but what if I wanted to find out what the midpoint of this box was, this surface here? Now, as I go up here, I've got a green line. That dotted green line you might be able to see is telling me that I am traveling down the green axis and I know I'm on the midpoint. But I'm looking for the midpoint of this. How am I going to figure that out? What I do now is hover over here. I've got to the midpoint there. Because if I do it quickly enough, did you see that? Because I hovered over there first, and then I went up and hovered over here, I now can go over. As I get near the middle, it knows that I'm at the midpoint, and it's now created a midpoint for me, and I can draw a line up. And I guarantee that that line is at the center of our box that way and the center of our box that way. The same goes for circles. So if I just draw a really quick circle, I'm just going to go that big. And what I want to do is draw a line. Now it's already done it for me. It's a bit of a letdown because I wanted to show you. Again, that's actually the strength of this inference engine. It's worked out what I want to do. I'll try to trick it again. It's already onto me, but because it's perhaps something I do a little bit of. But if I click on the midpoint there, it's actually the, okay, what's going on here? You can see that doesn't look like a really nice circle. It's actually a whole series of straight lines that make up a circle. But if I hover over the edge of our circle for a sec and then go to the middle, there it is, it finds the center for me and I can draw a line up. So there's a nice straight line out of the center. Very handy to know because often with objects, you want to have a point that's the middle of it for all sorts of reasons. The magenta line, if I was to draw a line from there, actually, this one might be a bit of a challenge to... Yeah, we're not seeing that magenta line. Don't worry about that. I don't want to delay the video. And that's a bit more advanced things in dragging things parallel. The input window down the bottom here, it says measurements. If I wanted to move an object, it now says distance. So you can see down the bottom right, it's gone from measurements to distance. So this box allows us to put an input in. That's usually a dimension or a measurement or a distance. And the data that we put in or the information we put in is relative to what we're doing. Now, we're on the move tool, so it's saying how far do you want to do it. Let's say I want to move this just 100 millimeters. I simply type on the keyboard now 100 and press return, and it's moved at 100. If you didn't believe that, what I'll do, now I'm moving it on the green axis, I'm going to put in 10,000 millimeters. And you can see it's moved right down there 10 meters away. I'll undo that. So when we are drawing, let's say we're drawing a line and we wanted to draw a line that was exactly 500, I just started drawing and press 500. The other way you can do it, if I go for my line tool again, click somewhere and just click. Now you'll see down the bottom right it says 1901 millimeters or whatever it was, 1904. If I click, before I do anything, if I type in 100, it'll automatically take that line that I just drew and make it 100. It knows, SketchUp knows what I'm trying to do. So you need to learn to remember that you can do it either way. Type in 100 and it's done, or click enter. Sorry, click and then 100 and it's done. The same goes for our move. So I've selected this guy here. If I want to move it, I can just move it anywhere. And then I might type in 400 and it's only moved at 400. I hope that makes sense. Move and copy. What we might do is get rid of that, and those guys. And I'm going to do some move and copying. When we move something, let's select it all. What I like to do perhaps is show you how we can move this block to be right in the corner there. Because when you're moving, a lot of people just grab it and try to move it and say, oh yeah, I've moved it. But we need to be a bit more precise in our drawing. So what we want to do is move it on the red axis, and we want to move it from that point along. And let's type in a distance of 200, and I've done that. It doesn't look like it, but because the scale of things, it did move 200 millimeters. So we can dictate exactly how far we want to do it. If we wanted to move this box, I'm just going to copy one for a minute. And what I want to do is I want to put this box, the center of this box here, on the edge here to make a kind of a brick pattern. What I will do is go for my move tool. Okay, it's zoomed out on me, so that's okay. I can still press orbit or H for hand. Remember those tools there, so I'm in my hand tool. I can zoom out a bit and I can go back to my move tool. Now what I'm going to do is hover over that area that I want to move. Remember it's the midpoint, so I've clicked it there. And now I'm going to go over here and hover over here. And now it's got to the end point. It knows, or I could have it on the midpoint there, but I want it on the end point. And what it did is it knew I was moving from one point to another point. So we'll do that again because it's pretty important. Make sure that's all selected. Hit our move tool. And as we hover over, it says, you might even see down the bottom, it says, pick two points to move. So we'll click that point there to move, and then what we have to do is click the other point to where we want to move it to. And as I hover over there, it's going to go to that point. So that's a very basic move, but that's how you would normally move in SketchUp. If an object is grouped, so let's just group that quickly. And we use the move tool. This is another important function of the move tool. Now we have these little red dots. So these little red dots, if I hover over it a bit more, you'll see it better. And then go back to the move tool. These little red dots allow us to click and drag. Looking in the box down the bottom, now it's become the angle window. And I'm going to rotate it around 180 degrees. And you can see that we can do that. I can click over this box, and it allowed that to rotate 180 degrees. So when a lot of people say, how do I rotate something? I think the best thing to do is to make it into a group, first of all, and then you have access to those tools when you use the move. If it wasn't a group, let's get rid of that. I just click it and delete it. Now I know this guy is not a group. So let's say I want to move it. First of all, I have to make sure it's all selected. So I triple click it, and then if I want to rotate it, what I need to do is find the rotate tool, which is this one here, rotate. So the shortcut for that's Q. And this works a little bit differently because I don't have any of these little red dots. So what I normally do is just find a line. Now, if I wanted to rotate it around the red and the green axis, I might just click on that edge or even down here on that corner. And then I click the line that I want to rotate. So in this case, I'm going to rotate this line and then just start rotating. Again, we've got the angle down the bottom, so we can do that. Let's just say we want to do it 45 degrees. What I'm going to do is type in 45 and press enter. So I can lock in an angle that I want. Now, let's say I wanted to copy this object. How to do that? Copy is found in the Move tool. So what we do first is activate the Move tool. And then what you have to remember, down the bottom here, on my Mac, it says Option equals Copy. So if I press the Option key, you watch the cursor here. There's a little plus symbol. On your keyboard, if you're using Windows, you'll press the, I think it's the Control or the Command. I'm sure it's a Control key. So when you press Control or again, it'll turn on or off. If you've got it on, let's have a start. What we might try to do is to copy this edge down to this edge. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to click there and drag it, and then I'm going to drag to there, and it snaps using inference right there. So that is how we can copy. Now let's say we copied both of them. Actually, let's select everything, and then I'm going to copy, let's say, this edge to this edge. So I'll press my Move tool, I'll click it, and press that option to get it started, and then drag it to there. And now you're done. Now, notice when I, here's something unusual. You saw that we had an individual block, and I could triple click it before, and it would select just that block. But because we hadn't grouped it, what it's gone and done is as we've copied it, it's become a part of a bigger set of lines and surfaces. And so I can no longer individually select this little block. It's now four blocks as a group, if you like. I shouldn't say the word group because that's confusing. It's just in a set of lines and surfaces. So what I should have done before I started copying things and moving things around was to have made a group. I'll get back to, I've just shown you there, I suppose, and let's say we just put another little, while I'm on that subject, I'll show you that if we did another line, I'm just going to draw some dodgy object on top of there. Now you can see that I can't select that object on its own either, so if I triple click it, and that will be the point for when we get to groups. When you are doing your copying and moving, just think about where you want to move things from. Sometimes if you're doing a technical drawing, you know that you need to move something, for example, 100 millimeters. So you will click into copy, get the copy thing set up, and then drag it, type in 100, and that's done. But often when we're wanting to copy something, we want to go from one corner to another corner. So you click where you want to start, and then drag it to where you want to finish. And that makes for much needed work. I find a lot of students kind of go, oh yeah, that's close enough, or I'll zoom in. Use the inference. Always use the inference, and life will be a lot easier in getting all your edges together. All right, so what we might do is get rid of this junk and just quickly draw a brick. Now, what we're going to do is make a brick wall using the copy and move function. What I haven't shown you is how to draw a line. So if we wanted to do something very basic, like just draw a line, we might say the brick is, I don't remember what a brick is, but let's say it's 250 millimeters and it's 200, let's say it's 100 millimeters that way. So I'll type in 100. Now, using inference again, I could, well, first of all, I could just go this direction and type in 100. Or I can go down here over there, hover over it, and then come up. As I come up, I don't know if you can see it, but there is a little dotted green line there. What that's doing is telling me that the red line now that I'm about to click is exactly the same length as the line parallel to it down here. So if we click there, that'll become 250 millimeters, and then I can click here to finish off the surface. By making four lines or however many lines all enclosed, I've created a 2D surface, a 2D object. Now, if you have this surface here, I'll go back and select this. If you have that surface, you can then do things like push-pull. Before we do that, I'll just show you the other technique of drawing a rectangle. So before we did that as a refresher, let's just say we did it there. I'll even use inference here to show you. So that's 250. Here I don't have anything to infer to, so I have to type 100. And here I can do that. Wait till it sort of snaps somewhere. There we go. So that's one way of doing it. The other way, which is probably more efficient, is, well, look, it's inferring to here already by, I've started the rectangle tool. It's kind of wanting to hang there. And if I just drag it out to roughly where I want it, if you have a look down the bottom in the dimensions now, it's already snapped. Well, let's make sure it doesn't snap. And you can see, oh, I have problems too. So sometimes you've got to move your mouse around to get it where you want it. But what I'm going to do is type in 250, 100, 100. What that will do is say that the dimensions of this rectangle are 250 by 100 millimeters. I'll just press enter and it's done. And if I wanted to show you again, I could just make it anything. And then again, afterwards, type in 250, 100. You get the picture. So I'm going to get rid of these because I just wanted to show you how to build a brick. So we're back to this object. If I click the surface inside and then go for this tool here, our push-pull tool, which we'll talk a bit more about in a second, I'm going to push that up. Let's make it 100 as well. Now, I'm going to group it, which I've kind of already talked about, but I'll talk about some more. And then I'm going to just get myself set up here. Now, I want to make a brick wall that's going to have, let's say, 30 bricks along. Of course, I could press move, hit the move tool, and then press that control or option key, and click to select in that corner and drag it down to that corner. All right, and you can see it snaps there. And then I guess I can do it again. I can still press the option key after I've started. Did you see that? So press the option key or the control key and it'll turn on or off. Now, we could do that 20 or 30 times and it'll take a long time to do it. Or let me show you another trick. So I'll get rid of that. I'm going to get my move tool happening. I'm going to click from there, drag it to where I want it, which happens to be exactly 250, and click. Before I do anything else, I'm going to type in on the keyboard asterisk, so that's shift 8, and then let's type in, 29, that'll give us 30 bricks altogether, and press enter. So what I've just done, here, let's press zoom extents to zoom out to our whole wall. I've created a whole bunch of bricks exactly next to each other. That's called an array, and it's a really handy way of doing repetitive objects. You can do that for bicycle spokes, for brick walls, all sorts of things. Now what I want to do, I've selected all of these bricks. I'm going to go to copy again, and this time I'm going to lift it up and drag it and pop it right there on the midpoint of the top of the brick, and therefore it's going to give me that brick pattern. And what I might do then is click those, I'm going to select everything. By the way, because I know there's only the bricks in this drawing, what I can do is press Command All. I'm wondering, Control or Command, depending on your computer. Windows will be Control. A, select all, and all the bricks are selected. So I know they're selected, and what I'm going to do then is maybe move it from, I'll move this brick down here in that little point. I'm going to then press my copy button and move it up to there. You can see what I've done. I've just been very careful about where I've decided to move and copy things from. And SketchUp with its inference makes life just so easy. You cannot go wrong. Before I do anything now, I'm going to press star. This time we might make that double course of bricks. What about we make a really big one and make it 50? So I'll type in 50 and it's going to make 50 sets of what we just did. And that, my friends, is how you make a quick brick wall in SketchUp. maybe a bit of useless info, but maybe something that you can use later on. And then if you want to knock a few bricks out, you can do that. Oops, I've just selected to edit it. So now we can have a little look through our brick wall and see what's going on. That's pretty cool. I'm going to get rid of all of those, except maybe for one. What I've done then, I actually just pressed select, Command A. I selected all of them, but I'm going to zoom in. I'm going to shift click. And this is something that's common in Windows and Mac. So you see how my cursor is now going plus minus. What that's doing, I can shift click as many as I want. What about we just press delete now? Because what I've done is unselected a couple of bricks. And that's what I'm left with. I actually want to get rid of those ones. That's my souvenir brick. So we might have a quick look at guides. Now, let's say with our brick that we wanted to modify it a little bit. I'm going to just do something because we haven't got to this point yet. So I'm making it simple. It's back to an ungrouped object, just a regular, simple little rectangular brick. A guide is like when you're doing construction lines. It's just a really easy way to draw up lines that you want to draw later on, or measure things by leaving them there as little ruler lines. So what I do, is I go to this tool here called the tape measure. Now the tape measure lets us do a couple of things. Again, I'm going to encourage you to remember inference. So we can measure from the midpoint, we can measure from the endpoint, we can measure by the midpoint and the midpoint, we can find the center point, all those good things. So if I wanted to measure from this point down to here, I've clicked, I just move my mouse down and then it snaps to that point and it's showing us it's 250 mil, or I can move down here without clicking and it shows me 100. So that's your tape measure tool to learn how to measure distances. You might have a look there. Actually, there's a little, it's called the tilde symbol, tilde 141. What that means is approximately, because remember at the start we set our drawing units up for single millimeters, no decimal points, then it's saying it's approximately 141 millimeters, but not exactly. So just something to know about. If you see any of your drawings having those little tilde dimensions, then you and it doesn't seem right, it probably isn't. So that's how we measure objects. But if we want to use a thing called a guide, there's a couple of ways we can do it. Normally what I would suggest is you click on an edge. So let's say I wanted to make a guide going up that's parallel to this line. I'm going to click on the edge, not on the midpoint, not on the endpoint, just on the edge, and drag it up. Now notice as I drag it up, hang on, it's hovering between the blue axis and the green axis. I want it on the blue axis, and then I know that line is directly above the line that I've just clicked on and dragged up. And let's just make it 25. Now I've made a little line that's 25 millimeters up, and say I wanted a line from here that's 25 mil in. Okay, so we've just simply created, and I'm going to actually go down. I don't quite know where I'm headed with this, but we'll see. I'll go 25 from there, and I'm going to go over to this edge. Now let's see what happens if I click from the center. Well, wouldn't you know it? I actually thought it does a line point sort of thing, something weird, but that's fine if you work it from the center. If you do it from the end, it doesn't work. It puts a dot, that little marking point, which is fine too, but I tend to like guides. I see them a lot more easily. So if you see those little things, that's still valid. It still creates a snapping point. It's called a guide point, and you can use those as well. Now, because we've done a guide, what we can do is now use a rectangle, and let's click here. When we've got guides, you're looking for this thing called the intersection. It's another snapping point, and we go down here, and you've got the intersection there. I now have created a nice little rectangle that's exactly 25 millimeters in from all the outside edges of this brick. And if I click it, I can select it. And if I click it, I can delete it. That's not a good practice, by the way. Well, depends if you know what you're doing. For now, I won't delete it. I'll do something else. Because if you wanted to make a hole in that brick, We're going to get to that in a sec. So I think I've shown you guides. I'll just remind you one other thing. We can click on guides and go to the midpoint. So when you're trying to find the center of something, it's really handy to use a guide as well. And there's the exact intersection. If I wanted to draw a line off that down the green axis, you can see that I've done that. So guides are very, very useful for quickly finding where the center point, the midpoint, whatever, and leaving them there. If you want to view your guides, say you've got guides everywhere and it's getting a bit out of hand, you can't really see your drawing, what you can do is go to view guides. So there you go, view guides, and turn them on or off. That keeps them, but you can get them back. Okay, so just tick or untick that. If you've had enough of your guides and you want to delete your guides, go to edit, delete guides. And they're gone for good. But I want to keep my guides. No, I don't. I'm going to delete my guides because we've talked about guides. I'm going to get rid of that line. Going back to this little rectangle that I've drawn 25 mil in from our brick, let's say we want to make a hole through our brick. There are two ways to do it. The bad way, I've selected it and deleted it because when I press O to orbit around, I've got a solid surface on this brick. See, if I select that and delete it, what I've done now is made kind of, I guess it looks like a tissue box. Maybe you want to do a tissue box. That's how you do it, I suppose. But there is a better way. So let's undo that and undo that. And what we're going to talk about is the push-pull tool. Before you make any 3D object in SketchUp, ask yourself, can I use the push-pull tool for this? Because as you saw when I made this brick, I had a rectangle. And then I just clicked on the push-pull tool, this guy here. This one. And I click it and drag it up. It is just supreme. But push-pull also deletes parts of your drawing. So if I wanted to get rid of this, all I do is click it, and I'm going to drag it right through the object to the back surface. Now, sometimes it's hard because it's kind of snapping. It's, that inference business is getting in my way. I want it to go there. How can I make that happen? I'll just go right over here to this edge. So I just hover over it and it knows I'm on the edge. That means that my push-pull is going right through to the other surface and click. I've just popped a hole right through the brick. So let's undo that and consider that if we go to push-pull and we can also go, I clicked the wrong surface. Push-pull, I can also push-pull things out that way, okay? And then if I had a little circle, let's say I wanted a circle somewhere in the center there, I can push pull and go through there. I want it to be on that edge so that I know, peekaboo, that it's done. So without even looking, I could have bet $100 that that circle went right through there because I let the push pull rest or the inference stopped on that little back edge there. So that's a little bit of push pull. One other thing you can do, let's say we wanted to take a corner off this box. Before you do it, what you need to do is create another surface. So I might go to line, and let's say we wanted to go from the center of this line down here to the center of that line. I now have created another face. So I've got a face here and a face here because it's separated by that line. So if I just get rid of that, I can press push and drag it. Now I can drag it. What about I drag it halfway? If I click along there, it's going to do it halfway because I'm on the midpoint of that line, or I can do it there, be the same thing. We could do that, or we can go right down to here and see what that looks like. That is kind of indicating to you when you get that weird little look that you are going to lose your push-pull part when it's done. If you wanted to create an object, now that we've done that angle, just something of interest, let me just put, I'm going to put a guide here just to be safe. I think this will work. Now, so I've made a center point on this surface. If I put my circle, now my circle knows that that's what I'm after. I'm going to click it there and do a push pull. So if you wanted to make a tank or something, I don't know what that looks like, but that's how you can do a circular or some other shape at an angle off an object like that. So let's get rid of that box. oh, here's something handy while we're at it. I've just messed up this box. Let's say I wanted to keep it, but I don't know how to fix it up. The simple way is to draw a line across a part of the geometry that you've got. In this case, the obvious line that's missing are these two. I don't think it'll work here. No, it hasn't worked. But you watch what happens when I click from here to here. It closes the surface, if you like, because it's now joined by a line all the way around, and therefore it creates a solid surface. So it's a handy one to know. If I delete that, just to show you again, I can do it on this one now. By drawing one line somewhere, it will do it. I could also draw a line across here. Sometimes when things get a bit more complicated, you have to do that diagonal, and then you just click on the line and delete it. So that's quite easy. Look, it's a nice box, so let's keep it. While we're at it, we'll draw a line. And for those of you who are making skate parks, you might want to know, how do we make a curve? So the arc tool is something, everyone loves curves, and using this tool, it's the two-point arc. There's actually lots of them you can play around, but I want to show you this one because it works very well with straight lines. We can click at the end point or the midpoint, whatever you like, but I'm going to go to the end point here. So we clicked to start, we let go at the end, and then as I drag it down, you can see there that it's creating an arc. Now, I think that's actually gone in the wrong direction. No, maybe not. Yep. Okay, so what I can do now is I could delete that. I can click that surface. I can go for my push-pull, and I could just push that out, and that's how I could make a neat little 3D object. If I wanted to scale this object, what I might do, I can select it all and then go for scale, which is this tool here, and it puts a box around it. It's a 3D looking box because we've selected a 3D object. If I want to scale it equally, as I hover over it, it says uniform scale about opposite point. So everything's going to scale in a percentage. As you see down here, that's a scale factor of 2, so I'm doubling its size. 1.5 is obviously half its size, that's still the same. But what if I wanted to do something a little bit different, like just scale it along its length? You can see that I can do that as well. And I can type in my scale factor there. Or if I wanted to perhaps increase, just trying to work out which is which, increase the height or the angle of the ramp, I can do it like that. And something where some things start getting a bit tricky, sorry, let's see if we can do that. But there's one other function I'm looking for. Yeah, anyway, you play around a little bit with it, but that's a really handy one to know about. Actually, I'm going to go back. This is what I was after. If I just select that face and then go for scale, now I've only got a 2D face. So now we can really muck around with the way we move things, scale things. So you can see there now that this back wall has got a real angle to it. So that might make for some pretty cool ramp designs and so on. I think the other way we can do this as well is if we click this and press move from this point, it's starting to mess up. But you can individually move objects. That gets a little messy as well. Sometimes using the proper tools are the right way to go. Let's get rid of all this, the Follow Me tool. Follow Me allows us to draw solid objects that are often, you know, more organic shapes, balls, maybe rooftops, skate balls, stuff like that. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because it's too much detail, but I could quickly show you how to draw, let's say, a nice circle. Before I draw a circle, what I want to talk about is how many sides a circle has in SketchUp. Let's go back. I've just clicked on my circle tool, and I could do it with a polygon tool, but I might as well just explain this because it's a funny trick. This one says our circle has 24 sides. What if I had a circle that only had 4 sides? Well, of course, it's not a circle. It's a square. But what I meant to do then, which was a bit of a fail, is I click that, I then type 4, and now my circle is a square. because I'm telling SketchUp that my circle only has four squares. You could do it to make a hexagon with six. Very simple. If you want a really smooth circle, maybe what you want to do is up the number from the default, which is 24, to maybe 48. Don't use a super big number because it simply puts a lot of pressure on SketchUp to draw all those lines. But you might look at that and say, well, that looks like a bit of a neater curve than what we had before. So if we want to draw a circle, a sphere, pardon me, I'm going to go to circle. I'm going to give it a radius that I know. Let's say 100 millimeters. Now what I want to do is a line. And if I hover over there, I'm looking for the midpoint. I've snapped to that. You can see how easy that was. And my radius was 100. So I'm doing a line 100 up. And I'm going to go underneath and do another line. Now, it doesn't matter that that line is there. It sort of knows. I'm going to click it from there and draw it down 100. Sorry, it does matter. Click that 100. So what I've got now is that little point at the top and the bottom is the same distance from the center as that outside edge. What I want to do is I'm going to select, first of all, I need to use my arc. So I'm going to put a line here. I'll just drag it out. I'm going to lock it to that red axis. Click it there. I'm going to put my arc tool from there to that endpoint. And it should say half circle. Don't you love it when things don't work in the video? And then I'll go for my arc tool. Click from the endpoint to there. Drag that out. I just saw that little magenta clicking going on. That's what I'm after. Not what I'm after. Sorry, guys. Pesky, I think I'm actually heading down the wrong path. What I'll do is delete that and do my arc, which I've forgotten. Okay, so I've got my arc line there to there. I'm going to click that. That's now become a solid surface. That's what I want. So I'm going to select this line, just that line, the circumference around the circle. And then what I do is click on the follow me button and I'm going to select that surface. And that is how, now I've botched something up because it hasn't joined equally. But if you look online for all the follow me tutorials, it's a really, really handy tool. To make all sorts of interesting 3D shapes. Another one quickly that I know I'm likely to have more success with. If we go up, and then we will just draw a line to the endpoint there. I'll select this. The other way to do this, we'll talk about that in a sec. So there is a pattern to that, and try to remember this. Click the circumference first. That's the path that we want to follow. You then click the tool itself, follow me, and you'll see the blue line disappear. That's okay. And then you click the surface that you want to have follow all the way around. So I click that surface. That's how that works. The alternate way of doing it is to actually select the surface, click the follow me button. No, you click the object and then drag around. Yeah, you click the surface you're after. Drag around and then click it. See, notice the red line. It's sort of telling you that it's following. And that works. Sometimes you have to do it like that too. So it's a handy one to know about. We've done arcs, follow me scale. Now groups. I've discussed already how if we make a quick object, and then we'd want to draw another object on top of it, which let's just say we'll do another rectangle. And then we decide, hang on, no. I don't want that little box on top of this brick. I cannot easily select it. I can select it. There is a way, but it's a pest. And there's no need to have to muck around getting stuck with that. So what we need to do is to go back, and every time you finish drawing an object, you need to make it a group. So I've triple clicked it, or I can wrap it up in a drag of the selection tool, and then right click and go make group. Okay, so that thing now is a group. And if I wanted to edit it, let's say I want to push pull that surface backwards a bit, I can't. So you think, why make a group if you can't edit it? You need to remember that if you double click a group, I'll click off it to undo that again, double click, it has now gone into group edit mode. And so now we can use any of our tools to do things like drawing a line on it, and we can draw another line on it. And then maybe what we could do is use our push-pull tool, and we can push that down halfway down there. And you can see that we've done that. Now, when we've finished editing our group, what we can do is just click off it. I'm just going to check if there's anything else I want to tell you about grouping. If you've decided you've really made a mess of a group, what you can do is explode it. Sometimes you might make multiple objects, in which case you want to have a collection of things, and then you group them together as a sub-assembly. For example, you might make a tire and then group it, and then you make the wheel and you group that. And then when you've got the wheel on the tire, you group that together. And you might need to separate them for some reason to change the tire or something. So what you do then is just explode it. So how to do that? Just click it and go explode. Or if you're editing, you can click right click and go edit group. That's the same as double clicking. But exploding it will turn it back into an individual part. Something I don't think I've shown you, I might make that into a group. And then I might hit my move tool, copy tool, move that along. Now I've selected it to there. This object, what I want to do is make a hole in the middle. So I'm going to flip this. So what I can do is flip it along the groups, red, green, or I think we'll go for green. And look at that. That's what I was after. So you can actually flip an object really quickly. It kind of mirrors it. That's a handy tool as well, which I wasn't planning on showing you, but what the heck, might as well. So let's say that we now have this object and we want to make another object inside of that. I'm not editing the group by drawing lines on it. By that, I mean if I remember before I showed you that I drew a line on my first brick, a little rectangle on it or whatever, and it got stuck. I couldn't get it off. But if I did another one now, let's just go for rectangle tool, put one on it, press push pull, lift it up. Notice I can triple click it. And then if I want, I can group it, or I could just move it out of the way because I'm not in edit group mode. So it kind of also isolates things. So you can draw things right on top of a group. And as long as you're not editing the group by double clicking it, you're safe. So what that allows me to do is to quickly use inference. And you can see there, I've clicked my line tool. And what I'm going to do is just make a solid object. That now I've made a surface, I'm going to just push that across to here. And I might group that as well. I can go right click, make group. And then I can just go move and lift that up. Up you go. How do I make it go up? I press the up arrow on the keyboard to lock it, as we did it before. And now you can see how quickly I can make an object inside using the other object's sort of hollows, if you like. That's just one little random thought that came to mind to show you something. And I can drag it back in to lock it in place. Just a reminder, if you're editing a group and you've finished editing it, you just click off. So I press spacebar there to get my selection tool working and then just clicked it and that undoes it. Now, the last thing we might talk about is components. A little more sophisticated, but a very handy one. What I'm going to do is just explode that, take it back to just individual part, and then I'm going to select it all. Instead of making a group, I'm going to make a component. Now, at this level, really there's not much difference between a component and a group, except that a component has a name and a component is a part. So let's call this component notched brick, because this brick has a notch in it. And let's say that we wanted to make a few copies of it. I'm going to make 10 copies. So I'm going to click here, just drag it down. I press my Alt key And I'm going to move them. Should we have them next to each other? Why not? And then before I do anything, I'm going to press star 10. Or in fact, I think it's 9, isn't it? Because we've already got 2. That should be 9 or 10 or 11 bricks or something. Now, here's the deal. Let's say we wanted to edit our brick. We've gone and made heaps of them, and it's a real pain to redo them and everything. Because it's a component, any change we make on one of them will affect all of them. So I double-click it to get into editing mode, just as we would for a normal group, even if it's a component. And I might press P for push-pull, and look what's doing. So we can change our notch. Now I'm going to make that notch go in just 50 millimeters. I'll type 50. And because I like notches so much, what I might do, I'll go back into edit mode. I'm going to draw a rectangle on that surface, starting from that point, coming down. I'm going to type in 50, 50, because you know that that means it's going to make basically a square. It's on the right axis by the look of things. Now that line's been repeated, and I might press push-pull there and push it in, and we'll go 50 there. What do you know? Didn't even expect that to happen, but it looks pretty good. So that's how components work. And when you're designing something, perhaps like a table, and you want to just fiddle around with the design and see how things look by making changes, it's enormously useful. So that's pretty much it. I hope that helps you with your SketchUp. We can use the little shadows button to just have a look at what our bricks look like in the sun. And there's lots of other tools. This doesn't cover everything in SketchUp, of course, but it's a good taster to get you started. And I really do hope it's been of some use. Thank you.